Hi again. I think I'll start just a bit by telling you our own experience in Artesia, and then I will get the floor for
And I'll jump
for
in.
Guide.
And if you have questions during this, this is not a formal presentation. Feel free to comment, jump in, and the more we talk, the more we can exchange information. Usually these meetings turn out to be more informative for everyone involved.
So I think the video was great in terms of explaining a lot of important points about what's going on in Artesia, the Family Detention Center. So we went there with Gaye and me went there on November 9th. We arrived and I stayed for 4 days and Gaye stayed for a week. Just to work as voluntary lawyers there, just to join the group that was voluntarily working there as lawyers. And as I said in the beginning, I am not a lawyer. I'm not actually working on immigrant issues. My own work is on environmental anthropology, so it is almost nothing to do with questions on immigration in the US. So it was for me also a new issue to get involved in. But a very striking one. So I was there as an anthropologist and also as mainly as a translator from English to Spanish. So we arrived there, we stayed in Roswell actually, so which is very close by to Artesia, another town, another small town.
Still 15 minutes drive.
Yeah. So we were each day driving
back
45 minutes. So we spend a lot of time in those desert plains, like you know, driving through those plains. And the first thing that, as we arrived there, the first thing that we realized was one of them was on the road, the huge animal livestock breeding industries. And basically, it seems like since they are really like desert plains, not a lot of production is possible there. So I think the main economy goes around livestock breeding industry and also
the dairy industry for New Mexico. So the stench is incredible when you're driving from Roswell to Artesia.
Yeah. And then as you enter to Artesia from Roswell or from any other points, one of the first things that you realize is also the oil refinery. Then you realize that it's a huge one. It's a really huge industrial structure, which we were struck by. And then we realize that it's the biggest oil refinery in New Mexico, actually. And where, this is a site information, that like, in 2010, two workers have died in the refinery. So this is like most general information about the environment where the detention center is located. It's a, as in the video, it is also said that it's a, in the kind of in the middle of nowhere, like a very small town, far away from city centers. And the detention center has opened in June, I think, 2014, when the numbers of women and children passing the border have really increased. And then the United States responded by opening new detention centers. The immigrants were detained in the border and sent directly to these detention centers. And I think as soon as it opened, it created a lot of critiques and critical voices because of the conditions. And also like just because of the fact that these people should not be detained at first, and then secondly, the conditions in the detention center are really, really, really bad for the children and for the women.
And because the government was not allowing people to file their legal claims and was deporting, and Laura Lichter, I think, mentioned in the video as well, that they're doing expedited removal to people who have legal claims for asylum, protection against torture under Convention Against Torture, and It's one more relief that's missing, but so three legal reliefs that there most people there are eligible for.
Yeah. So before AILA, Association of Immigrant Lawyers, American Immigrant Lawyers Association, started its work, its voluntary work in the detention center, many detained people were deported back immediately without any access to due process, actually, which was one of the scandals, I think, as well. So after AILA started the work, most of the people were able to actually pass the credible fear hearing, which is the first step, and then, you know, also have the bond hearing and to be able to release and to be able to continue their asylum seeking process outside of the detention center, as it should be, actually. So, yeah, this detention center is, yeah, like only women with children are kept in this detention center. That's one of the characteristics of Artesia.
From three countries, as mentioned in the video, Guatemala, El Salvador, and Honduras. And if there are women who cross the border who are Mexican citizens, they're actually taken to other detention centers. I'm not exactly sure why the government decided to take that approach, but now the government has announced officially that as of December 15, they will be shutting down the center in Artesia, and they will be sending the women and children who have not been bonded out to Dilley, Texas. And in Dilley, Texas, they're building a private, what the government calls residential detention center, which I question the terminology that the government specifically uses, and I'll get a little bit more into detail, but it's a holding center with 2,400 beds, and the women and the children will be sent to Dilley, Texas. And we actually have here Frank Johnson, also been to Artesia, and he volunteered for 2 weeks, and so if you have questions, we have, I believe, two lawyers in the room, unless I'm mistaken. But any legal specific questions?
Just about the naming of the place, just maybe it's important to mention that the term that detainees themselves use for to define the detention center is cárcel, which is in Spanish they talk about it as cárcel, which is prison, actually. So for the detainees there, it's actually a prison. So we should, I think about it vis-a-vis the naming of it as the residential, family residential center, which is, and the detainees who are, I mean, the people who are detained there are officially, we have been told by AILA that they are officially called as guests or
visitors.
Visitors,
or residents.
Rather than detainees. And also this is the reasons for that, one of the reasons is because just to not to count them within the numbers of detained people in the United States, which as the numbers are already too high, they don't want to apparently include those people into those numbers.
Yes, there's a lot of dual talk in the Orwellian sense that I think we all have to be very careful about. And I think we do see this in a lot of different areas nowadays, not just with immigration, but with other issues as well. You know, that's what we've experienced, Ekin and I. You know, we were told not to call, you know, detainees, the people who are being held, they're, you know, call them visitors. You know, this is not a prison, or this is not an internment camp, but it's a detention center. And I think, you know, this is extremely dangerous because there are facts, but then the way those facts are being made public, or the way media is presenting what's going on, and, you know, not Democracy Now, because that's an alternative independent source, but the mainstream media. So those were the things that also made us very uncomfortable. If you want to want to talk about the language problems or...
Maybe then you can also talk about this, the work that lawyers are doing.
Yes.
But they're being processed.
Mm-hmm.
Are they being processed in any way? Did you ask that? What's the difference between a detainee and being processed as an immigrant?
Being processed as a detainee or as an immigrant?
Yeah. I mean, I did not ask specifically.
So I read an anecdote of another lawyer, and this is what he did. He said, I would like to take my client out for shopping since she's a visitor. And of course, the ICE officer said, no, you cannot take your client out for shopping. So that's precisely what I mean in terms of watching out for that dual talk that the government is doing. Clearly, they're not visitors or residents. Clearly, they're detainees because they're not free to walk out. So.
The conditions within the detention center, as I said, and as you have seen in the video, we have experienced, we have seen, observed the same thing, that almost all the children have lost weight considerably, and many children were sick. So in the, actually you have seen the trailer in which we were working, the lawyers were working, and next to that trailer there was this medical center or medical trailer in which the doctors were working with the detainees, and each day we have seen a lot of children and women going in and out, clearly because they were sick or because of several reasons, and one of the first reasons is the food. They are not eating good food at all. Children are refusing to eat. Almost all the children that we have interviewed, the mothers, have told us that they are not eating anymore, that they only eat some of the crackers or some of the stuff that are being given to them, but not the main meals because they don't taste anything or they are really bad.
That every time they had to, they were in the cafeteria, the mother had to call an ICE officer, Immigration and Customs Enforcement, the police force of Immigration, Department of Homeland Security. When the ICE officer would tell the kid, you know, eat your food, then he would eat, and otherwise he refused to eat. At every meal, this is what the mother was telling us.
And one of the, so each night after, each day we were having meetings with all the lawyers who have been working there, and in one of the nights we have been informed that detainees have eaten for the first time, have eaten tortilla, which is one of their kind of like very traditional meals in Central America, and that news was like everybody was about to cry, that for the first time they have been given a real food that they can eat, actually. So, which was a result of, I think, the pressure that the ICE or the detention center is receiving by ALAF and all the work that lawyers are doing, or the activists are raising their voices. So it's like one of the results of the, I think, the struggle and resistance against the detention center. But just the fact that, you know, even the news that came about that they had eaten for the first time tortilla was like so striking.
How was your presence viewed by the ICE officers?
We haven't been in contact with, personally, we haven't been, I think, in contact with ICE officers, but AILA, the representatives, the kind of, the organism, the people who are in the management of this organization, of this work, are constantly in, Christina has been in constant dialogue with ICE officers.
Yeah, everyone has a specific role there, especially in the detention center, and there are strict rules. For example, every lawyer, we had to tape over our cameras and our cell phones, so the government clearly doesn't want any recording to be made public. And in the law library, where we would meet our clients, and it was a trailer, one of these structures that you saw in the video, where they set up these tables, I would say maybe 10 tables, in a very confined space, and a little corner just like this, where they had a video and a little corner for the kids, where the kids could sit and watch cartoons while the lawyers would do client intake and interviews. And, you know, ironically, the cartoon that was being watched every single day that we were there was Frozen, and you know, so there's ice, and there's the cartoon Frozen. And so we were told that by the time we were there in November that things were a little bit more relaxed. I mean, the officers were acting a little bit more relaxed. But Frank, you were there in September, so I don't know how they were treating the volunteer attorneys and the interpreters.
It wasn't a very collegial environment, to say the least. One thing about the ICE officials who were there, and I don't know if it was true in November, but certainly in September, there were two deportation officers in the middle of the trailer while at these 10 small workplaces that you mentioned were there. It was a very difficult environment in which these women were compelled, if they felt like telling their story, if they could get it out, it was a very difficult environment for them to do so with the uniformed ICE guys there, armed. To your question, what was the contact with ICE like? It was pretty cool, cold, cool, that sort of environment. And I mean, we had to check in every morning at 6:45 and get a badge, a day badge, so that we could be on the premises. We, the attorneys, were certainly not treated like guests or visitors. We were escorted in government vans from the check-in point to the trailer where we were doing our work. We didn't have access to come and go, not even to go out and get lunch. We had to be transported by the ICE officers.
That had changed by November. Yeah.
Okay. But certainly the residents, the guests, were not free to roam around the grounds. They had to be escorted to every place they went, even to their hearings, by an ICE officer. The only place where they were allowed to go was to the ladies' room, which frankly, when I was there, the ladies' room was located in an adjacent trailer. And in the middle of the ladies' room, with sinks on one side and stalls on another, was a barber shop where the ICE officers would get their haircut. And that created a rather chilling environment for women to use the facilities there, to say the least. It was a very uncomfortable and exhausting environment. One of the ICE officers said to us, he was the guy that was there every day, he said, you know, you attorneys, you're treating these women like puppets, like they were your toys. And so there was an element of resentfulness on the part of some of the officers. It was anything but, you know, a puppet show. Certainly the lawyers weren't the puppeteers. And another thing, I don't think that the ICE officers wanted to be there. They were sent there from all over the country, 45-day assignments, away from their own families, and I think it created a measure of resentment from their perspective. So it was a difficult environment, to say the least.
So,
Some people name Artesia, they call it the deportation mill, and I appreciated your comment because it's true. Even the government employees are coming, you know, for 45 days, or asylum officers who are giving these interviews, or volunteer attorneys. But we did meet one of our clients was there since the detention center was set up, so it had almost been it had been over 5 months when we were interviewing her, and you could just see in her this psychological effect of being in confinement for such a long time with two children and being so demoralized, because there were other detainees who got their hearings, who were bonded out. And just to clarify the, how the process works is there was a trailer that was set up with a video conference. So the hearings actually happen in Colorado, Denver. There are two immigration judges who were assigned. So the when we say hearings, you know, immigration court hearings, everything's happening through a video. So just imagine when you're talking with your friends or family members of how that feels, you know, on the computer screen, and then imagine being tried by the United States government, and as a result of that hearing, you know, you might be deported back to hellish conditions that you ran away from. And this is, you know, this is what's at stake. I've done asylum cases in my own practice with non-detained clients. Let me be quite honest with you. Sometimes it takes at least 10 client meetings for me to get the real story out of a client. It's extremely difficult for people who have been persecuted to talk about the conditions that they're fleeing from. There's at times rape involved, at times torture involved. It is not easy for a human being to trust another human being and to tell these problems. And this is the type of legal claims that we are talking about. And imagine the environment, the law library, which I described, and as Frank mentioned, where the client is supposed to give us the gory details of what happened to her. And her child is sitting at the corner watching a video.
Yeah, I mean, Laura Lichter, who was one of the founders of the Artesia Legal Defense Team, who was interviewed in that video, she practices asylum law and deportation defense from her firm in Denver. And she's, in a conversation with her, she said it takes at least 50 hours of attorney time to build a viable asylum case, because you have to develop that kind of trust. You have to collect the evidence, you've got to get witnesses, you've got to authenticate all of your documents, and it doesn't happen overnight. And these poor women in Artesia, if they have 5 or 10 hours to gather with an attorney, and it's generally not an attorney, this is a relay race. You were there for a week, I was there for 2 weeks, some lawyers are there for 3 days, and as you come into this environment, you're taking the baton from an attorney who was there on the ground, and you're doing what you can with that baton for a few days or a couple of weeks, and then it's time for you to get back to your practice, and now here comes the next person in the relay race to take the baton, and it creates a horrible environment for these women to trust. And to get their story out. And the whole thing begins at the border when they come across on a raft or however it is they come. And they're met by a uniformed Border Patrol agent who's armed. The next thing you know, they're in one of these places called Ibera, which is the freezer. Or they're in a van that's locked in like a cage. They're detained for days. And then maybe they get to see an asylum officer who's supposed to be a specialist in determining whether or not there's a credible fear involved. But the Border Patrol agent was a stranger. The asylum officer is a stranger.
The lawyer is a stranger.
Yes, when they finally get to a lawyer. And now that lawyer, that maybe you were inclined to trust for an hour or two is gone, and a new one comes in. And this whole trust dynamic is in danger of being defeated at every turn. And it's incredible that anything is getting done in Artesia under these conditions. And yet, the women, there have been what we call merits hearings, which is after you've had your bond hearing, if you can get out, that's wonderful. Many of the women can't get out, and that's another story. But when you finally get an opportunity to present your asylum case to the immigration judge on the merits, it's an enormous event. And there have been only 12 merits hearings since Artesia opened and the Legal Defense Project began. The first one was the week of Labor Day. It was the Thursday of Labor Day week. And I was there in the what they call the law library. It's hardly a library.
Library.
You know, but half of the attorney volunteers who were there had gone to court to watch this first merits hearing. And they came back, and there was genuine jubilation in that trailer because the woman won her case. And the basis of her winning the case was domestic violence. And the judge, who was a harsh judge from Arlington, Virginia back in those early days, said that this was a textbook case of domestic violence. And she cited in her decision a case that was decided by the Board of Immigration Appeals only a week earlier. And it was the first ray of hope that was happening in this environment. The very next day, there was another victory. The same thing, domestic violence. And there was more jubilation in the trailer because if they win the case, they're going to be released. And within a year, they can apply for adjustment of status and get a green card?
That means they will get green cards and they have a right to reside and work in the United States legally.
Right.
And 12 out of 12, ALA, pro bono team won all asylum cases. And the legal difficulty of winning these cases is actually related to how the law is constructed in the United States. To be an asylum applicant, a person needs to fit one of five categories. The persecution needs to be either caused based on religion, race, ethnicity, political opinion, or membership to a particular social group. The problem is making that connection between domestic violence, and in this case when they're female, it's because of gender-based persecution, what we call, and that connection of claiming that that is a particular social group. The difficulty with these types of cases has been convincing the immigration judges that how the law is written and what's happening, that these are valid claims. So this is why it was a huge win, because going into this, in terms of legal battlefield, it wasn't even an easy category to prove the asylum claim for these applicants. And usually if it's a domestic violence type of issue, historically it's been my understanding that they do not view it as refugees. And that's the other comment that I would like to make.
Well, that was changed a couple of years ago. So the big Supreme Court case, they said let's allow candidates and refugees.
That they can be considered
refugees.
But very recent. So, this is the whole problem, I think, because it's quite easy to label what we've been seeing, the surge, you know, all these women and children, and then some unaccompanied children as well, crossing the border in numbers that we haven't witnessed before. It's possible to call this a refugee crisis. So the president called it a humanitarian crisis back in June, yet still they're trying to combine it with, you know, it's an immigrant problem, it's a migrant problem. The reason why I try to emphasize this is because there are standards, legal standards, under international law that if there is a refugee crisis, that certain measures need to be taken. And international organizations can come in. And in fact, UNHCR did offer United States to come and help out with this crisis. But of course, United States didn't want to have anything to do with that. So that's why I think it's important to think of these terms. And of course, you might have heard Obama passed, or came up with this executive action. And I just want to mention a little bit on that, but I don't know if you want to jump in before I get into that. Because it's all related to how the government is responding to this crisis and what the public thinks is happening that is truly not really happening.
Maybe just one short note on that, and then it's just, it's been said a lot by Ayla and by other activists who are raising their voices against these family detention centers or prisons, is that this is actually a step that the government has taken just to send a message to the would-be refugees that possibly would come in the future to the United States. And like, you know, these detention centers being, and the fact that these people are kept as detainees in those centers, in those prisons, is just to send the future possible refugees a message of that. Do not come here. If you come here, we are going to detain you, and this is where you are going to end up. And Ava has been, I think, mentioning this, that this is in line with what the security secretary, the secretary of security,
Homeland
Security, Johnson, has made a declaration of saying, we will send you when the crisis was at the peak. He said, you know, we will send you back and immediately for deportation. And this is kind of a message, and Ayla is saying, I think, that you cannot detain anybody just to send a message for the future refugees.
I apologize if I was
listening. I think we have to also think about this issue, not only a problem about just about these countries, just about the local conditions in these countries, or failures of the governments, or, you know, the failures of the cultures, whatever you call it. It's not, I think we should think about those cases in relation to international political economy as well. It's like all of, most of the gangs that are, that have, as you say, a huge amount of power on people, on governments, on the economic structures in those countries, have those powers because they also manage the drug trade in those countries and in international trade. So unless we, I think, criticize and question the whole international political economy, which leads to those, you know, which kind of promotes those drug trades and all those economic structures, we cannot really understand the refugee crisis or the source of crisis that we are facing today.
Yeah, I agree with Ekin's comment. And if you're interested in this topic and if you want to learn more about it, there's an excellent book, and maybe some of you already know. But in the beginning of the video, you saw Juan Gonzalez on Democracy Now! And he wrote an excellent book called Harvest of Empire. And it talks about what happened in El Salvador and Guatemala and Nicaragua and Honduras, and what happened to these countries, say, after NAFTA was signed, after the free trade agreement was signed, and how the societies were affected, and what happened when multinational corporations couldn't get the tax breaks in Puerto Rico, I believe after 1998, I might be wrong, but they ended up moving these big factories into these countries to be able to benefit from the tax benefits and the labor standards that are not quite the same as here. So there are a lot of connections, and I agree, thank you for bringing that up, because it's not just about immigration.
So I have a question just about the, so when you're defining, I'm just curious, so when they define the legally, when they're, so I understand obviously that domestic violence cases should be considered for asylum, like, just, but so legally, how do they go about, are they just
when you were saying the groups, because it goes into the category of like specific social groups, does that mean that, like, when if you were to go to case for a judge, and
I know what you're trying to ask.
Yeah.
How to show that?
Like for yeah,
how
for
to
every
prove
specific
that.
Case.
And I'll give you an anecdote because this is exactly it'll answer your question if not. But during the credible fear interview that I had in Artesia, after I prepped the client maybe for 20 minutes, mind you, because it was the only that's how much time we had. We went into this interview and my client was testifying to the asylum officer the sexual abuse that she suffered throughout the years and how her husband would periodically beat her and how her son also he beat the son and his arm was broken in one of these incidents. And one of the questions the asylum officer wanted to get on record to feel comfortable doing the job she was doing was that she wanted to elicit testimony from my client that said, I was abused because I was a woman. So the way this happened was, as she kept telling her story, the asylum officer said, why do you think he did that? And she would say, I don't know why, he just did it, that's how it was. And so she'd come back to it, but, you know, did your husband ever act violently against an elderly person or a priest, or, you know, and she didn't understand where this was going. So my client felt, you know, and being asked over and over and over again, you know, why do you think this happened? Why do you think this happened? Because the asylum officer was trying to fit her into that particular social group to be able to prove, you know, allow the claim she was persecuted because of her gender. So I had to stop. I said, I think I know what you're trying to elicit from her. Can we get to it in my follow-up questions? Because after they're done with the questioning, we have a right to do follow-up questions. And we did it, but it was like torture.
What?
I asked her, did you ever witness, did you ever see your husband ever act violently or beat or attack an adult male? So,
and the answer was no.
The answer was no.
So it is like,
and so this was the particular social group.
It is horrible.
I know it's not satisfactory in terms of this is not how life works, but this is how.
So then in cases like that, would you tell the client beforehand, like kind of let them know what?
It's impossible to get to that point in 20 minutes because in 20 minutes you're trying to explain to the client that they have to give all the reasons why they're fleeing their country and that they have to meet that standard of credible fear that if they're sent back to where they're coming from that they would be killed, most likely killed, abused sexually, and you know, so this is, you know, this is something very specific that, you know, that's not really. I mean, if I had 10 hours of client prepping, sure, I would explain the process and how it works and what they're trying to find, you know, elicit from her. But otherwise, and we are also not. We're not supposed, and maybe Frank, you can share your opinion, but we cannot feed our clients the testimony we want the judge or the officer to elicit from them. Our job is to bring out the true story, but you know, in this case, clearly, if I knew, I would have explained it to her, but we didn't have enough time. And when married women go and try to complain to the police, the authorities send them away because, oh, you are married, your husband, you know, can treat you the way. So to your question, would I apply for asylum for a woman coming from Turkey who has suffered domestic violence? Yes, without a doubt, I would.
But by that definition, again, every single Chechen female that would make it to the United States deserves asylum.
Can I?
That's ridiculous.
So for asylum, for 589s, it's case-by-case basis, right? So for asylum claims, it's case-by-case basis. So even if you have, you know, in a BIA case, if you're saying a certain particular social group that has been named, they're saying in that case, we're going to find asylum because you met the social group, you have the nexus between the fear and, you know, your persecution. So there's that connection there. And so in this case, we're going to grant it. It's not saying that, like, in every single case where you meet this certain definition, thus you're going to, you know, get asylum. So I think it's almost like the suggestion that there's this floodgate that will open. I don't think that you can say with asylum, just because a particular social group has been named, thus everyone who meets that social group qualifies for as asylum. It's not done that way. It's case-by-case basis. I mean, correct?
Correct.
But by their own definitions,
yeah,
every single one of them,
yeah,
qualified because every single one of them is being abused by their husband. It's customary.
Okay. I would like to, if you're interested, I would like to give a little bit of the background of immigrant detention in the United States because I didn't know much about it. And clearly, you know, Artesia made it to the news, but I thought, is this something new? Is this connected to the privatization of the whole correction system in this country? Or was this a practice? And what I found, and I'm an immigration lawyer, but I literally found out about this in the past 48 hours, was that this has happened before in big numbers. In 1987, the ACLU filed a claim against ICE and tried to challenge, based on constitutional grounds, that refugees or people with valid asylum claims, again, women and children, should not be detained. The litigation took 9 years. It wasn't resolved, therefore they had to settle. So ACLU had to settle with the government. Because at first I thought, why would they settle? You have to keep fighting. This was happening in 1987. Here we are, 2014. Nothing has changed. Why did they settle? And I'm sure that was not an easy decision. But the government has the upper hand in the sense that they can drag out the litigation as long as they want, whereas ACLU is a nonprofit organization. And yes, they do have their kick-ass legal team. But resources may not even be comparable in that sense. And also, during 9 years, you still have immigrants being detained, so what are you going to do? Can you settle? So there were certain required conditions that came out of that settlement with the government. And some of those were, for example, previously to the settlement, children, they would wear the uniforms, and they would be held in cells up to 12 hours a day, and they didn't have access to education, and there were no standards for healthcare. One comment that I should have even mentioned at the beginning, immigration laws in the United States are not under the criminal code, they're under civil code. So when we talk about immigration laws and regulations, we are in the realm of civil, not criminal. So imagine that someone who entered this country and just because they have crossed the border and they don't even have a criminal record, they're being held in these detention centers, in practically prisons. So these kids, there were certain conditions, and that was actually for children, for minors. And in 2007, there was another scandal. And it was by the same company that runs, that will be running the Dilley, Texas Detention Center. It's called CCA.
Corrections Corporation of America.
It's a Tennessee company, New York Stock Exchange, public shares. It's very lucrative business, apparently. And they were around in 2007. There was a different center, Don Hutton Center, I think in Pennsylvania. And again, AILA sued the government and said, hey, previously we had this settlement agreement and you're not upholding these standards. And by 2009, that center was shut. In that center, they were holding about 600 women and children, so very similar to Artesia. So we just keep seeing it. And the general question that I always have at the back of my mind is, you know, we want to fight for social justice, and there are clearly many ways of doing it, but if I had to put it on different ends of the spectrum, and I keep going back to this question, number one, do you act diplomatically and shake hands with the authorities who are the cause of the oppression and persecution? Ekin and I have had this conversation a lot because we said, look, Ayla is doing something. If Ayla did not negotiate this law library, our clients would not even have access to the volunteer lawyers. And to be Ayla, that means you have to talk to the government and negotiate terms. At the other end of the spectrum, it are organizations that actually are more after investigating and exposing what the government is doing and take a stronger stance against. Yet, if you do that, you know, the government will not give you the access and you will not be able to set up your law library and help your clients. So I always, you know, have in my mind, you know, it's a fight for justice. There are many ways of doing it. And it's not necessarily mutually exclusive, obviously.
We can call it as a multi-layered
struggle
as well. It's
yeah.
not necessarily.
And one of the layers I wanted to point out that because of the laws of many countries that are have the license to grow marijuana,
mm-hmm.
a lot of Mexico cartels are losing money
mm-hmm.
because now they Americans could grow legally. Now they could have the farms and the dispensaries now. So maybe that's another layer that's another part of it, you know, because a lot of it is, you know, the gangs that are selling the drugs. Well, you know, now that they're losing money, maybe the abuse is going to go up.
Right.
So. And I think that there's a connection there. There really is.
I absolutely agree. And, you know, in these countries, the violence is related to gangs
yeah.
that are in the
and
business
the
of providing drugs.
Right.
Where's the demand?
Right.
It's actually, the market is here.
Exactly. Yeah.
There's a lot of business for them. Clearly, and that's precisely what you mentioned. Once you legalize the drugs here,
yeah. why
there will not be.
Yeah.
So, you know, and that's an excellent point you made, and I just want to add one more thing. You know, they say, oh, is it a bad thing? Is it a good thing with the Obama executive action? I just want to say it's not bad or good. We just need to look at the facts. And the facts say there are close to 12 million undocumented people in the United States. And the Obama administration will allow 3 years of work permit to people who come out of the shadows. And they're calling it deferred action because all that means is we're going to put your file for 3 years. We're not going to look at it. But after those 3 years, we can deport you anytime we want. Deferred action is not a green card. It's not a status.
It can be abused by an employer.
And yesterday, the Congress passed legislation, the Republican Congress passed legislation saying the president does not have legal authority to pass this executive action. And the Obama administration said they're going to clearly veto this and that they think they have legal basis. But in the White House, statement that they released, there's very interesting language that you can really dig deep into it, and then you'll understand that unfortunately the other side is creating the discourse for this. They're setting the language. They're, so this is what's buried in that statement. It came out yesterday or today after Congress passed the legislation. It says, we want people to come out and pay their taxes, and we want them to report, so we know who has criminal records and who has what information, because with this 3-year law, people will register and then the government will have this information and they can use it however they want after that point. You know, the executive action doesn't even give them that. So, and they always focus on this security threat, you know. It's a security threat, and we have to, it's as if it's a terrorism issue. That's how they're seeing it, and Obama administration responds to it in the same way in their, statement.
I want to ask a question about the privatization process of these detaining centers. So you told that the one in Artesia, they're closing it in a few months, and then what is going to be
next?
How many people will stay in these detained centers?
That's a really difficult question because the government is not releasing exact numbers. There are people bonded out every day. There are people being detained and put into detention centers every day. The ACLU just filed a FOIA request, which is called Freedom of Information Act, asking ICE to release the exact number. In Artesia, it's approximately 600 people, women and children.
Yeah.
And if they're not bonded out by December 15, they will all be moved to Dilley, Texas.
And Dilley, Texas facility or prison has,
2400.
You mentioned the 2,400 individual capacity. And the estimations are that the CCA, the corporation, will make almost $300 per person per day from in this prison.
So it's a public company, New York Stock Exchange, lucrative business, where there's no value to being a human being.
Yeah.
It's just
it's
a commodity.
Yeah.
So the ALA is calling this. Because ICE kind of announced that we are shutting down Artesia as if it is something, it's still positive that has been taken in response to critiques and everything. And Ayla, with the declaration, made a press release saying that this is just a shell game. You are just shutting down one center because you are opening a new and huge one. And I think it's the biggest immigration detention center in US. And you are going to just,
have you met with other agencies
here
in Massachusetts, like NIDA?
Mm-hmm.
And what are their takes on? What have you folks been organizing about or around?
I haven't had a chance to talk to Mira yet.
Oh, okay.
It's definitely on my to-do list.
I know.
It is.
I know you're super busy.
It is. And we do need to organize against
this
because this is connected
to
the privatization of the whole correction system, and it's so there's a lot we need to, and there's a trend here.
Yeah.
You know, there's a trend. The numbers keep going up. Artesia is 600, Dilley is 2,400. And last year in the budget legislation that's so lengthy, they buried in there a clause, the Congress did, that requires ICE to hold on average 34,000 detainees per day. That's a quota. They're giving a quota to ICE and saying you gotta meet your numbers, you gotta keep arresting people and putting them in jail. So
that's not new. They do that with the police departments,
and it's always buried in the budget legislation in this like one little, and it's very sneaky, and it's
I think a couple of years ago there was a news in Texas. They passed this law that police can stop like any immigrant looking person, put into jail,
yes,
and then all the private jails. So basically, even though if these people can get asylum and stay here, once they're out, it is like almost cat and mouse game. They will put in the back on those jails so that these people can make money. It is a terrible thing to do, especially in this country, America. Like, we are talking about being free, talking about the freedom and human rights, this and that, but then you really do this like with law, you know, putting people in the prison so some people can get rich. You know, basically,
well, it's not just people can get rich. There are laws in this country that allows them to do it. And we vote for the legislature for all those laws in.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Yeah.
So
I mean, yeah.
Everybody has their own responsibility.
Yeah.
Well.
So basically, it just comes down to the point that when you're trying to solve this problem, having these people to have a better life, but eventually they are going to get caught, they are going to go into jail, so there is no end to this problem unless we change the whole system. I don't know if it's possible.
That's a really good point, because I think public opinion matters a lot, how these laws are enacted. And at the beginning I mentioned the dual talk and how the government is calling detainees visitors and residents, and sort of related to this, there's a really good book Emra suggested to me called The Latino Threat by Leo Chavez. And it's a smart title because it talks about how in this country there are millions of people who believe certain things that are far from the truth. What are these things? That there are terrorists coming through the border every day, that the Latino population, they're actually, they have a secret plan to called Reconquista, to take the lands back to be prior to 1848, the war with Guadalupe, and that they want like a Quebec-style independence. There's no truth to this, but people do believe this. There's another one that, you know, Latinos, they do not want to learn English. They do not want to integrate into society, that they always stay within their communities and there's no intermarriage. And this book goes through all of them, and that how the media, you know, pumps this into and shapes the public opinion as if, you know, these people are a threat to this society, and it's far from the truth. And it's been shown statistically, too. You know, we always talk about economics. It's not true. Second generation, third generation, they unfortunately stop speaking Spanish. There's so many intermarriages. They've done U.S. Census statistics. You know, how many, I mean, talk about terrorism. Who's coming through the Mexican border to blow up, you know? So.
And just a note on that, it's a not directly in relation to Artesia, but you know, the whole American farming system is relying on the migrant agricultural workers who are, like, even the food that we are eating here in America is hugely based on the immigrant workers' labor. And they are really working in really bad conditions and like suffering. And there's a new documentary film, Food Chains, about it. If you want to see it, I haven't seen it yet, but it seems to be a really good film. So the whole, if you think how the whole economy is based on this cheap immigrant labor, and then how, on the other hand, they are labeled as threats, and all sorts of discriminatory discourses are in play.
I have a question that I really do not understand. This is the basis of any legal system, that if there are two people who committed the same crime, the punishment should be same. Let's assume that Ekin is a detained woman in Artesia, and you are a woman working in a restaurant here. You are both undocumented, came to this country with the same way. You pass the same border, and she's in the detention center, and you are out. You are one of these 12 million of undocumented people in this country. Why she is in the prison, and why you are free? So you committed the same crime according to laws. So why the authorities are taking one to prison and the 12 million are out? I do not say 12 million to be in prisons, but why these women are in prison? Why?
Do you want to jump in?
I'm also an immigration lawyer. A lot of it is availability of evidence. It's subjective. We are meeting the same, you know, the two stories, if you have identical stories from two different women, the testimony you're able to elicit can vary. I mean, she's exactly right. I worked on a trial for almost 9 months just to get testimony out. And to your point before, you know, one case that I worked on was about a woman who was persecuted during the Rwanda genocide. That was in 1994. So, yes, arguably anyone who was a victim of the genocide would have a basis for a claim. But in reality, when you get before either if you're doing an affirmative case or a defense of asylum thing, you know, the majority don't even make it to a point where they have the opportunity to present their case. But the point is that should they have the opportunity, if they meet the basic legal requirements, to request asylum? Yes, but in reality, when you get before a judge, when you get before an asylum officer, is the evidence there? Most of the time, no. Are you able to get the, I'm talking about like, just some of these times you have to prove this thing happened. You're talking about things that happened many years ago in a different country. People don't have access to their records. People don't have access to family members. They don't have access to, they can't say, I was attacked on this date by this person. Where are you going to get those records when you're, you know, thousands of miles away from home and many years have passed?
Or even if you were, say, attacked and abused by your husband, are you going to go to the police to report, or are you going to go to the hospital to get treatment? Because that's the kind of evidence that we are technically looking for. You know, you're telling me this incident happened on this day. I need to prove this to the authorities. Did you report this to the police? Do you have a police report? Did you check into a hospital where you had broken bones? And we're talking about, you know, people who have been persecuted, have been injured, who do not necessarily have these papers.
For example, I had a woman who, you know, on her body, she was attacked by machetes, covered in, you know, bruises and wounds and things that were still visible all these years later. And her case was still, she was before an officer for an affirmative asylum claim. She was still denied. So we had to get it to trial before a judge, and we said, hey, we brought her before all these doctors and brought in all these medical reports. But, you know, to us, we're like, okay, it's clear that this woman is psychologically and physically, you know, the evidence is there. It's there, but she's not able, without legal counsel or without other forms of assistance, to present that information. So that the difficulty is, I mean, again, 20 minutes is nothing. And she's exactly right. You are not allowed as an attorney. I can easily say to a client, it's because you're a woman. But you're not allowed to do that. And a lot of you have to explain, the language barrier is a big problem. I mean, the amount of time
just
to translate,
right?
Even
yeah.
though
yeah.
you can't
yeah.
translate
yeah.
legal terminology to someone in a foreign language, just the basics of, you know, getting what happened on this day, you can ask the same question 10 times and they'll get a different answer. They're not exactly lying, but memories change and you're dealing with people who've been traumatized.
Mm-hmm.
So the stories you get each time will be different, not because it's not the truth, but because people remember things differently, and when you're in a state of stress, you're not necessarily remembering things accurately.
So much gets lost in translation. In my Artesia credible fear interview, even the asylum officer had sufficient knowledge of Spanish that she realized that the telephonic interpreter was not doing a good job. So she realized and she said, okay, we're done, interpreter, and requested another interpreter. So, but imagine if it were an officer who did not have sufficient knowledge of Spanish. What's going to happen during that interview?
So an important addition to the language barrier. A lot of indigenous women are in those detention centers who not necessarily speak Spanish
no.
and who do not have to speak Spanish. And they suffer a double discrimination there, because like, at least some Spanish is persons like me, or some immigrant lawyers themselves know Spanish, so they can somehow like interview the detainees. But we have interviewed, Gaye has interviewed one indigenous woman
from Guatemala,
I think, and she was only speaking Quiche, and
it's been months
that they, until they, like Ayla could have found somebody who was voluntarily a professor in a university teaching Quiche, was at the end able to translate over the phone, and even that translation didn't really work, because like the accent, or I don't know, maybe you have different accents in Quiche as well, that the professor was not sometimes fully understanding the
detainee and etc. And that, like, you could see how much she suffered for months being kept in this detention center, not being able to speak to anybody, not being able to see any, to have any lawyers until they found a translator. There are a lot of indigenous communities in those detention centers as well. This is a huge problem.
And one of the clients,
she
kept
was
apologizing.
Yeah, kept.
I'm sorry, I don't speak Spanish, and I'm sorry, I don't speak Quechua or Achu. We can't get you an interpreter because we couldn't even go through her client intake. I have one final comment, but if anyone's, I have no doubt that this period in U.S. history will go down as what the United States government did to Japanese Americans during World War II, when they set up the internment camps where they put innocent people, where they confined them and treated them like they were less than human beings, and that it will go down as a shameful history. I have no doubt about it, and I hope it stops soon, but it doesn't look like it's going to stop anytime soon.